Pedimos al doctor Alejandro Poiré, decano de la Escuela de Gobierno y Transformación Pública, nos dé unas palabras de bienvenida.
Muchas gracias. Creo que eso que suena es mi celular. Hablando de tecnología, ¿verdad? Pero bueno. Muchas gracias. Muy buenos días a todos. Les damos la más cordial bienvenida al Tecnológico de Monterrey. Para mí, el día de hoy es un honor darles la bienvenida y agradecer de manera muy puntual y muy precisa al Consejo Nacional de Ciencia y Tecnología, al doctor Enrique Cabrero, que hoy nos acompaña, por el apoyo para la realización de este seminario. También a la Corporación Andina de Fomento, Banco de Desarrollo de América Latina, que ha tenido el interés y la visión de apoyar este esfuerzo. Y la iniciativa de José Ramón López Portillo y de Carlos Elizondo Mayer Serra, profesor visitante de esta institución, profesor del CIDE, porque para la Escuela de Gobierno y Transformación Pública del Tecnológico de Monterrey es muy importante no solamente entender la realidad actual, sino reconocer que hay otro México en curso, que hay otra realidad en curso, que tiene que ver con el cambio tecnológico, que tiene que ver con transformaciones que trascienden el ámbito estrictamente gubernamental y que necesitamos hacernos la pregunta desde el ámbito público de si vamos a ser simple y sencillamente testigos de esa transformación o protagonistas de la misma. El evento que hoy nos convoca es el inicio de una serie de seminarios dirigido a un público muy especial como el que hoy nos acompaña. Les agradezco puntualmente a cada uno de ustedes el estar por aquí con nosotros. Aspiramos que esta sea una discusión ilustrativa y una discusión útil, no solamente para este entorno, sino para nuestro país. Muchas gracias por acompañarnos.
Gracias, doctor Poiré. Agradecemos al doctor José Ramón López Portillo, quien nos acompaña a la Universidad de Oxford, nos dirija unas palabras.
Mi propósito aquí es explicar un poco el contexto de estos seminarios y en particular el de esta primera sesión. Vivimos en una época de cambio tecnológico exponencial. América del Norte está generando la mayor parte de este cambio en toda la gama de las ciencias prácticas y está induciendo al resto del mundo a su desarrollo y aplicación. No obstante, la difusión tecnológica es muy regular y a menudo controvertida. Si sus beneficios no alcanzan a todos, se puede convertir en instrumento de marginalización, de discriminación y hasta de control social. Los retos del cambio tecnológico son inminentes, se nos vienen encima como un tren cargado que además aumenta su velocidad constantemente. Países en transición como México tenemos la oportunidad de ser susceptibles positivamente a estas tecnologías, pero también de sufrir sus peligros. Tenemos que abocarnos de inmediato a entender el problema y a encontrar soluciones. En el siglo XIX, y el principio del siglo XX, se nos fue la oportunidad de la revolución industrial que impulsó a otros países a una posición de dominio global. En la segunda mitad del siglo XX se nos volvió a ir la oportunidad de entrar de lleno a la economía del conocimiento, fincada en la innovación y el desarrollo de tecnología, como lo hizo, por ejemplo, países como Corea del Sur y otros. México es la décima economía del mundo en paridad de poder de compra, pero es la 72, según el Banco Mundial, en economía o como economía del conocimiento. La 61 también en el índice global de competitividad. Ojalá y este y otros esfuerzos lleven a que en el siglo XXI nos podamos montar en el nuevo, quizás último tren de cambios y oportunidades y prevenir ser atropellados, como decimos en México, que nos lleve el tren. México está haciendo hoy un gran esfuerzo para dar un salto hacia la nueva economía del conocimiento y de la innovación, que ha probado ser condición insoslayable de un desarrollo socioeconómico competitivo y sostenible. Las élites políticas, empresariales y académicas mexicanas parecen estar cada vez más empeñadas en atraer el apoyo internacional e invertir más en ponerse al día, conscientes de que los bajos estándares educativos y de la fuerza laboral mexicanos dejan al país, lamentablemente, muy mal equipado para absorber la innovación tecnológica. Con gran visión, el doctor Alejandro Poiré, que lidera la Escuela de Gobierno y Transformación Pública del Tecnológico de Monterrey, apoyado por el doctor Enrique Cabrero, aquí presente, del CONACYT, y también por el Banco de Desarrollo de América Latina, organizaron este seminario a partir de la presencia de los mejores expertos a nivel mundial. El seminario busca sensibilizar a administradores públicos, a líderes empresariales, académicos mexicanos y a los forjadores de la opinión pública sobre la importancia de responder organizada, decidida y concienzudamente a los retos y oportunidades de las nuevas y poderosas tecnologías y a su estudio sistemático, profundo y permanente. Los temas que se estudiarán comienzan hoy con la estrategia tecnológica y el futuro de la inteligencia artificial, ofrecida por el profesor Nick Bostrom. La relevancia de este tema es ser la punta de lanza del cambio exponencial en las otras líneas de avance tecnológico y en explicar quizás las transformaciones profundas e irreversibles que enfrenta la vida humana, para bien o para mal, y los riesgos existenciales que corre. Las sesiones siguientes, según se está o se ha acordado, a lo largo de este año abordarán la revolución robótica, la nanotecnología y sus aplicaciones, la biotecnología, medicina personalizada y neurociencia, en el caso particular del transhumanismo, dimensión, implicaciones y riesgos sistémicos del cambio tecnológico acelerado y cambio tecnológico, política pública y el futuro de la democracia en México. Ojalá y puedan ustedes participar en las siguientes sesiones.
Muchas gracias, doctor López Portillo. Nos acompaña el doctor Carlos Elizondo, profesor invitado de la Escuela de Gobierno y Transformación Pública.
Gracias. Es un placer estar con ustedes en el arranque del seminario y sobre todo un placer presentar al profesor Bostrom, Nick Bostrom. Profesor Bostrom, como ven ustedes en su currículum, voy a ser muy rápido, es profesor de la Facultad de Filosofía en Oxford y en la Escuela Martin School of Oxford, Oxford Martin School. Dirige y fundó el programa del futuro de la humanidad y es director del programa del impacto de la tecnología. No podría yo aquí leer todo lo que ha hecho el profesor, es realmente increíble por su alcance, por su amplitud. Les sugeriría en particular que leyeran este magnífico libro que se llama Superintelligence, que se encuentra, no lo traje para mostrárselo porque lo bajé en el Kindle, pero realmente te permite entrar a un mundo que desde nuestra perspectiva, tan ahogados en los problemas inmediatos, no nos damos cuenta que ahí se están cocinando unos cambios de un alcance extraordinario. ¿Y quién mejor el profesor Bostrom para dárnoslos, para explicárnoslos? Tenemos una plática como de 50 minutos, luego me encargaré yo de moderar una discusión con los que estamos aquí enfrente y por supuesto con ustedes. La presentación será en inglés, si alguien necesita traducción simultánea está disponible y no haría más que invitar al profesor Bostrom y agradecerle su presencia con nosotros. Por favor, profesor Bostrom, the floor is all yours. Apparently, the other mic is not working very well.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the kind invitation. I'm delighted to have the opportunity here to talk to you. Should I be holding this or should I be? Maybe I can. Something like that? That could work?
That's great.
Let's see. Yes, yeah, so let's. So I run this group at Oxford University called the Future of Humanity Institute. We are a bunch of mathematicians, philosophers, and scientists with the unusual mission to try to think carefully about the really big picture questions for humanity. And so some people, when they hear about some of the things we're doing, kind of think this is interesting, but it's kind of far out there. It's a little crazy, a little science fiction like. What I like to say then, let's look at the human condition. This is the normal way for things to be. When we kind of take a step back and reflect on this and think about this from a larger perspective, then what we take to be the normal way for things to be, the way that we have an alarm bell that goes off in the morning and we commute in to the office and then sit in front of a computer screen all day and struggling to lose weight rather than to get enough to eat, is actually a huge anomaly from almost any conceivable point of view. Certainly, on an evolutionary timescale, the human species is a recent addition here on Earth. We've only been around for 100,000 years. And even on a historical timescale, this modern human condition where we have escaped the Malthusian condition is only a couple of hundred years old, and even then just parts of the world. Of course, in space as well, this little thin crust on the surface of planet Earth is a huge anomaly. Almost everything that there is ultra-high vacuum. It's just large emptiness and burning gas clouds. So if one thinks about it from that point of view, this normal human condition actually seems to be a kind of anomaly that would not be so surprising if it changed in some way. Another way to make a similar point is if we just plot world gross product over the last 10,000 years. And what we see here is basically a shape like this. It's not a graph upon which I would like to sit. It just looks kind of odd to imagine that right now this particular point which we have reached is some sort of normal permanent way for things to be. It looks much more like we're in some kind of transition. What is the cause of this current anomaly? I mean, I think the proximate cause is largely all the amazing technologies that the human species have developed that have enabled us to build complex societies and to be much more productive than we've ever been before. But I like to think back further. So the ultimate cause, I think, is human brains. It's through these small changes in human neurophysiology that made us slightly cleverer than our great ape ancestors that have enabled us to develop language that then enabled us to invent technology and for those innovations to accumulate from generation to generation to generation. So here we have two eminent men of their species. We have Kanzi. So he has accomplished the amazing feat of learning 200 lexical tokens. And Ed Witten, who's unleashed the second super string revolution. And they are really very similar. If we look under the hood, like, this is what we find. Basically the same thing. So one is a little larger than the other, but it's pretty much the same thing. There might also be some small differences in the exact way in which their brains are wired. But we know that these invisible changes cannot be too complicated because it takes a very long time for complex adaptations to arise. And there have only been maybe 250,000 generations of evolution since our last common ancestor. So a relatively small number of changes to the brain structure has then taken us from Kanzi to Ed Witten and from the situation where we had broken off tree branches to the current modern condition where we have intercontinental ballistic missiles and where we're worried about overeating. So if we kind of want to represent this in a more abstract way, then I think it can be useful to draw a kind of diagram like this, where on the one axis here we plot time, and then on the other some rough measure of capability, like level of technological sophistication. And in this kind of diagram, what we think of as the human condition, represented here by the interval between the two dotted lines, is a very narrow band of all possible conditions. There is a kind of lower boundary on the human condition. In population biology, there is a concept known as minimum viable population size. So if you have too few individuals left of some animal species, then the species goes extinct. It cannot maintain itself. There's too little genetic diversity and it dwindles to extinction. And there is then this stable attractor state here at the bottom, extinction. Like once you are extinct, you tend to stay extinct. So one long-term outcome for the human species could be this stable attractor state, extinction. We know that more than 99.9% of all species that ever existed on this planet are extinct. So it certainly is like a common way for things to go. I think there is another possible way, though, to exit the human condition, and that's sort of in the upwards direction. And there too, there is, I believe, a kind of attractor state. So if you imagine things go well over the coming century or two, and we kind of reach technological maturity, meaning develop all those technologies we can already see are physically possible, maybe develop the means for like true space colonization, we have developed superintelligence, I'll talk more about that later. At that point, a civilization that reaches that state also might have a very good chance of ending up in this upper attractor, which is the state of increasing the bubble of space-time that you have colonized, and eventually you reach all or almost all of the accessible parts of the universe. And like you can continue for billions of years, suddenly the bubble just spreads and spreads, colonization of space proceeds, and it just looks like it's much harder for a civilization to go extinct once it's already developed all the technologies that are possible and survived them, and once it kind of become a multi-planetary civilization that is spreading. So once you reach that stage, it might be pretty much kind of on a track that you might continue on for millions and billions of years until you reach this ultimate end point where there's a limit to the amount of stuff that an intelligent civilization starting from Earth can ultimately access because of the expansion of the universe. Because the universe is expanding, things that are too far apart will have kind of moved away from us at a fast enough rate that when we got, even if we traveled at the speed of light in that direction, like there's a certain point beyond which by the time we would have reached there, the rest will have receded even further. So there's a finite bubble of stuff that an Earth-originating civilization could eventually reach. And that, I think, is another possible attractor state. But the probability that we will remain within this human condition, the longer the timescale you're considering, the more likely it is that we will exit it in either of two conditions, either of two directions. So a lot kind of hinges. From a moral point of view, it looks very important which of these two directions we will exit the human condition in. If we just make some very simple-minded kind of utilitarian calculation and we just count the number of human lives that are on the line, let's first make the simplifying assumption that we will forever be restricted to the resources of planet Earth. So set aside for the time being any possibility of space colonization. So we might then say the Earth will remain habitable for another billion years if we succeeded somehow in achieving like a really sustainable, safe civilization, then you know humans might live for a billion years, maybe at a population of a billion individuals or so. So that would correspond to the possibility for 10 to the power of 16 human lives, if a human life is 100 years, let's say. So what this conservative assumption would imply is that if we do, so the normal way in decision theory, in the simplest way, just multiply the value with the probability and that you calculate the kind of expected utility, right? So if we just apply that simple-minded way of calculating the value of reducing existential risk, then we get this very striking conclusion that the expected value of reducing existential risk by a mere 1/1,000,000th of one percentage point is at least 100 times the value of saving 1,000,000 human lives. In other words, even the slightest decrease in the risk that we will fail to eventually realize this great possibility would just be worth a lot more in this kind of utilitarian terms than curing cancer or eliminating world hunger or achieving any other good that has merely local effects, which is striking. And it might well be that the main effect of doing one of these things, like curing cancer or eliminating poverty, would actually be its indirect effect on the level of existential risk. This is, of course, if you hold this kind of utilitarian ethics. Like I think there are more things that should come into the equation, but just to kind of highlight how one particular value perspective seems to indicate that existential risk reduction is really super important. Of course, if we relax this assumption that the human species could only ever exist on planet Earth, then we get an even larger number of the number of lives that could be lived in the future, which just makes the conclusion even stronger. So those kind of reflections motivate the introduction of this concept. I call it existential risk, but it's basically the risk that we will permanently destroy the future. So this includes human extinction scenarios, like once you're extinct, there is, you've destroyed all the future. But it could also include some other scenarios in which we permanently lock ourselves into some really radically suboptimal state. You could imagine some kind of world totalitarian dystopian regime that were forever immune to overthrow. Like maybe it had really good surveillance technology or some new technology that could manipulate and engineer people's desires, or like a perfect lie detector or something like that, which maybe just could lock in some radically suboptimal conditions. So that also could count as an existential catastrophe. So on this kind of schematic here, we plot on two axes. On the one hand, the scope, like how large is the population of people that would be affected, which could go from like a personal risk, like something that would affect only one person, up to a global risk, something that affects everybody who's alive. But beyond that, there are even larger scopes, something that affects also future generations. And at the other axis here, severity, like how badly affected would each affected individual be, which could range from imperceptible all the way up to crushing, like something in the ballpark of as bad as death. Like, so it could be for an individual, something of crushing severity might be death or lifetime imprisonment or permanent severe brain injury, something that kind of radically reduces your potential to live a good life. And so on this kind of schematic, an existential risk would then be one of crushing severity and pan-generational scope. And for the kind of reasons that I just outlined, it might then look plausible from this kind of utilitarian perspective to adopt the Maxipot rule, which is that we should maximize the probability of an okay outcome, where an okay outcome is any outcome that avoids existential catastrophe, as a practical rule of thumb for action. It just looks like if a utilitarian follows this principle, they will do, for almost all realistic situations, the thing that will have the highest expected utility. And it kind of would simplify decision making. But even if you're not a utilitarian, you might still think that the values are so big here that it should at least be one important consideration. So this is some of the reasons why the concept of an existential risk is an important one in the work we are doing, that helps kind of focus our attention on a subset, that there are all kinds of things that could go wrong and have gone wrong throughout history, all kinds of local catastrophes and temporary setbacks and all manner of issues and problems in the world, but really only a very, very small subset of those would potentially rise to this level of an existential risk. And so our attention is largely focused on that small subset. This is not really reflected in current academic priorities, however. We did a little literature review a couple of years ago where we counted the number of scientific publications on different topics. And as you can see, academia has a fairly strong interest in the dung beetle, quite the strong interest in snowboarding, and a non-trivial amount of publications on zinc oxalate, not so much on human extinction. There is no clear mapping between how important a topic might be and how much attention it receives by academia. Now this is, okay, so it's not maybe entirely fair. There are like a lot of papers that have relevance to the question of human survival, even if they are not using the term human survival. So the big literature on, say, nuclear arms races and thermonuclear war, or global warmings and asteroids and stuff like that. So if you counted all of that, it would be less extreme. But still, it's fair to say that the topic of the big picture, future for humanity, and risks to that picture have been quite severely neglected by academia. If we do kind of zoom in and then ask, like, what are the actual main existential risks to humanity, it's natural to subdivide them into two types. Ones that arise from nature, and ones that arise in some way from human activity. And it's possible, even without going into the details, to see that it's plausible that all the big existential risks, certainly if we're thinking about the time scale of 100 years or so, arise from this second category, from the anthropogenic category. And the way to see that is that the human species, as I already noted, has been around for 100,000 years already, and we have survived during those 100,000 years asteroid impacts, volcano eruptions, earthquakes, firestorms, all kinds of things that nature can throw at us. So if we survived all of those for 100,000 years, it's not really likely that they will do us in the next 100 years. By contrast, we humans will be introducing entirely new kinds of phenomena into the world in this century, and particularly we are likely to make various technological breakthroughs that will give the human species unprecedented powers that we might then use for good and ill. So it looks likely that if there are any big existential risks over this time frame, they're more likely to come from this category of novel phenomena than from the category that we've already tried and tested for 100,000 years. Another way to make kind of the same point but with a different framing is to think metaphorically of human history as the process of extracting balls from a giant urn that contains a lot of balls. So these balls represent ideas, discoveries, inventions. And so throughout history, we reach into this giant urn of ideas, and through research and experimentation and curiosity, we pull out one ball after another. We make new discoveries. And throughout history, we extracted a large number of these balls. And the net effect so far has been hugely beneficial. This is why we have kind of exited the Malthusian condition and now have this bizarre modern condition. Some of these balls, maybe we can depict as gray. They've kind of been mixed blessings, some good consequences, some bad consequences. It's actually not that easy to think of a technology that we can be sure we would have been better off without. There are certainly a lot of technologies that have some bad side effects, but it's hard to pick one that we would have been better off without. I mean, maybe you can make the case for chemical weapons or nuclear weapons or some torture instruments or some specific things, but for the most part, we have extracted either white balls or sort of light gray balls from this urn. What we haven't so far done is pull out a black ball, like an idea or a discovery that invariably spells the end of the civilization that discovers it. Could such a thing exist? What would that be like? It might be helpful here to sort of do a little historical counterfactual. So sort of 60-70 years ago, people reinvented nuclear weapons. So we were lucky in the sense that it turns out that in order to create a nuclear bomb, you need these rare and difficult to obtain raw materials. You need highly enriched uranium or plutonium, and these substances are difficult to get hold of. You need large manufacturing facilities, huge amounts of energy, big footprint, expensive, difficult to do, large signature. Suppose it had turned out differently. Suppose it had turned out instead that there had been some simple way of creating nuclear weapons, like maybe by, say, like baking sand in your microwave oven. Right? Okay, so now we know that it's not possible to make a nuclear weapon by baking sand in a microwave oven. That's physically impossible. But before we actually did the relevant research in physics, how could we have known in advance of doing particle physics and atomic physics and quantum physics what we would discover? Like, it could have turned out to be the other way around. So if that had turned out to be the case, that there had been some easy way to unleash the energy of the atom, then maybe that would have been the end point for human civilization. Because once it became easy enough for any individual in their garage to unleash the destructive power to kill millions of people, then it might have been impossible to have cities. Like, in any population with several million people, there will always be somebody who is crazy or who is a terrorist or who wants to blackmail others. And if they really could bring down a whole city, then that might have been one of these black balls that we... So in that instance, we were lucky, but if we keep pulling out these balls, then, you know, if there is a black ball in there, we'll eventually pull it out, and then that will be the end of it. So at the moment, our strategy seems to be to just hope that there isn't such a ball in the urn. Because what we don't have, we have the ability to pull out a lot of balls, but we don't yet have the ability to put the ball back into the urn. We don't have the capability as a global civilization to uninvent an invention. So that's another way of saying that that's why I think the biggest existential risks are from this category of anticipated technological discoveries. So we can kind of outline some potential technologies that could carry existential risk. I'll say a few more words about machine intelligence in the second half of my talk today. Another area is synthetic biology. You could imagine that maybe that could make it possible for small groups to wield enormous destructive power without rare raw materials. Like, once you have access to the kind of experimental apparatus to print out the RNA string of smallpox viruses or modify them and so forth. Of course, all of these also have enormous potential to do good and to have enormous benefits for economy and medicine and the environment and in all manner of fields. It's just that they also possibly might have these applications for destructive uses. Molecular nanotechnology might be another one of these. If we consider existential risks that don't involve extinction but a permanent lock-in, then maybe totalitarianism enabling technologies that make it, that kind of change the political dynamics in some undesirable way. So we know throughout history what kinds of political systems have tended to arise has been influenced by technology. So the development of writing made it easier to administer large empires with like keeping track of who had paid their taxes, and you need some way to make records to be able to do that. Like gunpowder helped end the feudal era because you could sort of blow your way through castle walls. And so there might be other technological discoveries that will kind of change the social-political dynamics that determine the scale of political integration and what kind of systems arise. And again, obviously that could go in the upwards direction as well. We could, and in fact we hope that these changes will be for the better, but I don't think we have the level of political science that can make very accurate predictions about what would happen if you fundamentally change the ground rules of the human political game. You just don't have that predictive ability. Human modification, you could imagine if used on a wide scale, very unwisely, to change human desires or human nature in some way. Geoengineering. And I put in a lot of these unknowns here, because if the question is, what are the biggest existential risks over the next 100 years or so? Well, suppose you had asked a similar question 100 years ago, and ask people then to nominate their like most likely candidates. It's interesting to note that none of the ones that I might currently put high up the list would have been mentioned. I mean, they certainly would have worried about machine intelligence. They didn't have computers yet, right, 100 years ago. Synthetic biology wasn't even a concept, nor was nanotechnology. They might have worried some about totalitarianism, but for the most part, the risks that now loom large on our radar like wouldn't have been even on the radar 100 years ago, so we should have the humility to recognize that there might be additional risk factors that we just haven't discovered yet, which incidentally suggests that there might be significant value in studying these things in case we could discover another possible thing that we could do something about. I'll introduce one more theme before moving on to the idea of AI and superintelligence. So this is some notion of, so I think it's plausible that we have a kind of weak form of technological determinism, in as much as obviously the details of what happens depends on what people do, what they fund, which fields attract talent, the regulatory environment, and so forth. Nevertheless, I think it's fairly plausible that if there is some possible technology that has a wide range of different potential uses, like some general technology, then eventually it's likely that that technology would be developed. You can think about it a little bit like if you had a big box that starts out empty, and then you start pouring in sand into this box. This activity of pouring in sand corresponds to funding scientific or technological research. So depending on where you pour in the sand, that will influence where the pile of sand starts to grow. Right? If you put it in the middle or on the side, there will be a pile of sand in a different area. So to that extent, like human choice influences what is happening. Nevertheless, if you just keep pouring sand into this box, eventually the whole box will fill up, kind of independently of where you start pouring the sand. So I think similarly with regard to investments in science and technology, humanity is pursuing a wide range of different things. In the end, if we just continue this, we will eventually kind of probably discover all the kinds of general purpose technologies that will be discovered, assuming we don't destroy civilization first. So this kind of technological completion conjecture, I think, is fairly plausible. If one do think that something like this is possible, but one also thinks that there might be these possible existential risks as well as huge benefits from various technology areas, what implications does that have for what we should do? I mean, you might think that even if there are these big risks, if these technologies will be developed eventually anyway, like we're gonna develop these things, so if there is a black hole, we will extract it. So we might just go ahead and hope that there isn't any. Because if we're gonna keep discovering these technologies, we will eventually hit upon it anyway. So we have no ability, it would kind of be futile to try to attempt to like stop that activity. And so one attitude, and I think it's like quite well formulated by this blog commenter Washbash, some random person on an internet blog wrote this. I think instinctively go faster. Not because I think it's better for the world. Why should I care about the world when I'm dead and gone? I wanted to go fast, damn it. This increased the chance that I have of experiencing a more technologically advanced future. So this is one answer one could provide. And I think that, well, we have to be like careful about what the question is that we're asking. But if the question is, what do we have most reason to hope for insofar as we are egoistic or asking the question, what would be best for us, for my family, for our friends, for the currently existing people, then I think Washbash is probably correct. We have reason to hope for as fast technological development as possible. For more or less the reasons he said. I mean, the default outcome for all of us that we are dead anyway within a few decades. We are kind of slowly rotting away from the aging process. So if we don't die sooner from something else, we'll all be dead or senile or kind of within a few decades anyway from just aging. That's kind of the default. The only way that you could possibly break out of that would be some radical upheaval, like somebody invents a cure for aging, somebody figures out how to upload human consciousness into a computer, like something really radical would have to happen in order to... And even setting aside that, at least if technology moved forward rapidly, then we would have more interesting gadgets and maybe a higher standard of living. So if the question is, what should we hope for insofar as we're asking what is best for us, then faster development seems the answer. However, if we ask a different question, like what would be the best thing from the impersonal point of view, if one is asking what would be best impersonally construed, like what would create the most value in the future, then it's not at all like obvious that maximum speed forward is the thing that would maximize this expected value. In other words, it's not obvious that maximum speed forward is what will minimize existential risk. And I think perhaps instead a principle like this, the principle of technological development, is closer to the mark. This would say that we should retard, or at least refrain from accelerate, the development of dangerous and harmful technologies, especially ones that raise the level of existential risk, and accelerate the development of beneficial technologies, especially those that reduce the existential risk posed by nature or by other technologies. So the intuition here is that even if in the fullness of time all these technologies will be developed, it might nevertheless be important exactly when they are developed. In particular, the sequence in which they are developed. Like a simple-minded example could be in synthetic biology. Suppose you think that synthetic biology will at some point make it possible to create like a really nasty designer pathogen, like a virus with long incubation time, high lethality, high mutation rate so that it avoids attempts to vaccinate against it. But suppose that synthetic biology also at some point in the future will develop like a really clever technique for manufacturing vaccines quickly, or a really good diagnostic, or some really good antiviral drug. Maybe all of these technologies will eventually be developed. Now, it still matters the sequence. We would want the antidote to come before the poison. Like, we would want the antiviral drug to come before this supervirus. And similarly in other technology areas, like with AI, if we're eventually going to develop artificial intelligence, and there is also this possible technology that would make artificial intelligence safe, it matters a great deal what the sequence of arrival of these are. So we should think for... So the right question to ask, I think, is not for some possible technology X. Is X a good technology or not? Would we want X or not? Is the world better off with or without X? Rather, the question we should ask is, do we want X to enter the world like 2 months earlier or 2 months later? Like, this is the kind of difference that we might make as a funding agency or as a talented researcher. We are basically moving things around in time. By funding research, you're moving the introduction of an idea into the world from a slightly later time when it would have been discovered anyway, maybe by somebody else, to a slightly earlier time. And so thinking on the margin about what the best timing of different technologies and ideas, I think, can help us make sense of some of these macro strategic issues for humanity. So now, in the Second, so how long have I been going for, roughly? I want to make sure I leave some time for Q&A. I've been half an hour. Okay, so that means we have some time as well to talk about superintelligence, which is the topic for this recent book. Make sure the book, yeah. All right, so you saw that this was one of the items on this list of existential risks. In fact, the top item there. And it's an interesting technology because it also, I think that if there's going to be a breakout from the human condition in the upwards direction, I also think that's most likely to get through the creation of superintelligence. So I think it has enormous upside and enormous downside. By superintelligence, I mean any intellect that radically outperforms humanity in all practically relevant fields. And so there are a number, well, kind of two basic paths you could imagine reaching superintelligence. On the one hand, we could imagine some improvements of biological intelligence. It has improved over evolutionary timescales, like the highest level of intelligence. At the moment, biological intelligence is kind of far above machine intelligence. If we're thinking about general learning capability, general planning capability, sort of general purpose smartness, the ability to learn any occupation and to learn anything, we are kind of far above where computers are today. On the other hand, computers are kind of improving at a more rapid clip. So looking at a little bit more granularity, we can distinguish biological, biomedical cognitive enhancements, like going into the human brain and intervening in some way, and I'll say more about that just in a second. We can also imagine technologies or improvements that increase the efficiency with which we work together as epistemic communities, that kind of enhance communication or the way we aggregate information, make us collectively more intelligent, able to solve more difficult problems, even if the individual brain is not changed. So epistemic institute, you could think like the discovery of scientific peer review in the scientific journal, the scientific method back a couple of hundred years ago, like dramatically increased the rate at which we could solve scientific problems. And the internet, you know, makes it easier for people to come together in various, and there are probably more discoveries like that to be made. I'm not going to say very much about that here, but I do think that that's an important category. Then we have this kind of intermediate category, so brain-computer interfaces, like the cyborg path, where the idea is you would maybe combine the best of machine and human by implanting, say, chips in the human brain. Or I don't think that that's where the action is going to be. I think it's just very technologically difficult to significantly enhance general intelligence in a healthy human being by implanting, say, chips or other technology into the body in a way that you couldn't do by having the same technology outside of the human body. So I'm often asked, like, wouldn't it be really cool if you could like access Google just by thinking about it? And yeah, I guess that would be cool, but then again, I can access Google already. Like, I have a cell phone in my pocket, and I don't need to have the thing like operated into my brain in order to have that functionality. And there are a lot of advantages to having it out. Like, every time a new version comes out, I don't have to check into the neurosurgery to have like an operation. It just looks very difficult. I think for people with disabilities, there are all kinds of exciting applications. If you are deaf or blind or paralyzed, but it's just very hard to do something better than the healthy human organism. I think in the long run, it will become possible to do a lot, but maybe only after superintelligence already has been achieved through some other means. And then, of course, the machine intelligence path, which I'll return to in a second. Let me just briefly say something about the biological cognitive enhancement first. So the place where I think that will first become technologically feasible is in the context of embryo selection or genetic engineering in embryos. There are other paths you could imagine, like pharmacological ways, but again, I think it's hard to really significantly enhance human intelligence for those. And I'm happy to discuss that more in the Q&A, but I think that it will become technologically feasible first by selecting among embryos. So we did some calculation about the kind of effects that you could get from doing this. So at the moment, what is missing in order for the technological ability to do this to exist is not really any new technology. It's just information. So at the moment, we don't yet know the genetic correlates of variations in human intelligence. We know that there is a large component of intelligence which is heritable, but we cannot yet like connect that to individual alleles. And the reason for that is that it turns out it's not just sort of three or four or five different genes that people have that account for this variation. Instead, it's thousands of different alleles that each have a very, very small effect. But in combination, they help explain the additive heritability. And so in order to find these alleles with very, very small effects, you need very, very large sample sizes. At least hundreds of thousands of individuals, probably in the low millions of subjects. And that has not been possible to do, full genome sequencing of millions of subjects, because the cost has been prohibitive. But with the rapidly falling price of gene sequencing, it is now becoming possible. And there are currently underway studies with hundreds of thousands of subjects, and in the next few years, very likely we will have millions of subjects. And I think that will begin to uncover some of the genetic architecture of human intelligence. And once you have that information, you don't need any new technology. You just need a decision to use it. And so in the context of in vitro fertilization, usually some number of embryos are produced as a result of the fertility treatment, maybe 8 or 10 or 12. And at the moment, the doctor then kind of selects one to implant based on like visual observation, like he doesn't select the embryos that look abnormal. And you can also screen for certain chromosomal abnormalities or monogenic disorders, but you can't currently select for intelligence or other complex cognitive traits. But once you have this information, there would be nothing to prevent somebody from using that information as one of the criteria to select. And it's possible to estimate roughly what the gain in average intelligence that would result from selecting embryos for intelligence. I'm using intelligence here as an example. In principle, you could, of course, select for any other trait that has an additive heritable component. Different societies might make different choices. But if you select, say, the best of one in two embryos, the expected intelligence of the selected embryo would go up by maybe 4 IQ points, very little. Well, it would significantly reduce the risk of mental retardation and so on. And if you select from larger and larger sets of embryos, you see that the expected gain goes up, but you have steeply diminishing returns. So selecting, say, one embryo from 1,000 rather than 100, you don't get 10 times like the gain. You get diminishing returns. But this looks very likely to be feasible because it doesn't require any new technology. It just requires more information of the kind that scientists are busy gathering anyway for all kinds of other reasons. It's like a lot of applications in medicine and behavioral genomics and so forth. So there is another potentiating technology that would greatly increase the selective power that you could get. And this would be if you had the ability to create gametes from embryonic stem cells. So the idea would be you have some embryo, you extract the stem cell, and then you use that stem cell to create sperm and egg, and you could use those to produce more embryos, and you could use those embryos to produce more stem cells. So you could, with this kind of technology, create multiple generations of selection in a petri dish over the course of a few months, rather than like normally like a human generation takes 20, 30 years, but here you could like do it all in a petri dish over the course. So if you had this, you could enormously increase the amount of selective power that would be at the disposal for some society that wanted to use this. So this would require new technology. It would require the ability to create gametes from stem cells. So this doesn't yet, it's not yet ready for use in humans. It has been done in mice, so it's not like a science fiction technology, but it needs to be kind of, and so the drivers for this is mainly sort of fertility treatment. So there's like companies like Ova Science that are investing in this. But once the technology exists, maybe for treating infertility, then the technology would also exist if somebody wanted to use it to combine with genetic selection. And with that, you could get vastly greater increases from doing multi-generational selection. So compared doing one-shot selection of creating a pool of 100 embryos and picking the best. So according to our estimates, you might get 19 IQ points or something like that. But if instead you did 10 generations of selecting the best of 10 embryos, so the same number of total embryos are involved, but you did it multi-generationally, you might get a genome that has a higher disposition for intelligence than any that has existed in the history of the human species. So this technology could potentially be very powerful. So obviously there are enormous like ethical issues that arise in this, and but if we're just asking like where would it first become technologically feasible if somebody decided to do it to significantly enhance human intelligence, this would be my bet. It's possible that instead of genetic selection, genetic engineering will get there faster. There have been rapid recent advances with CRISPR and other gene editing technologies, and it might turn out that before this would become relevant, there will be the ability to sort of just sort of edit or design a genome to specification, in which case that kind of would be a superior technology. Like it's kind of why generate a lot of embryos and throw almost all of them away if you could directly just build the embryo you want. It's an open, I think this has a higher certainty of getting there, the genetic selection, but the genetic editing or engineering is kind of a wild card. It could turn out to get there before. So this is kind of one path to superintelligence, and it's an open question in my view whether this will result in superintelligence before or after we would have superintelligence through machine intelligence. There is like an inbuilt delay in any attempt to achieve superintelligence for embryo engineering. Like even after you had the technology today and you used it today, it'll still take 20 years before like the child could grow up, and even longer before there would be a sufficient number of them to really have an impact on society. But if we're thinking that AI is far away, that it's going to happen maybe in the second half of this century or towards the end of this century, then it's quite plausible to me that at that point it will be a different version of humanity that will be doing the creation of the AI at that point, a cognitively enhanced elite that will be driving the sort of scientific progress at that time. So some people suggest to me, so the book talks a lot about some of the risks of artificial intelligence. So sometimes it's proposed to me that if there are these big risks from AI, maybe that's a reason that we should push ahead with these biological cognitive enhancements, so that even if computers get smarter and smarter and smarter, that we could kind of stay one step ahead. Now, I think that's fundamentally misguided. If we do embark on biological cognitive enhancement, I don't think it's going to delay the time until computers overtake us. I think, in fact, it's going to make computers overtake us sooner, if anything, because you will then have these cognitively enhanced computer scientists who will be doing the research, and they will, if anything, discover AI more rapidly. There might be other reasons for why one might favor cognitive enhancement. Maybe you think if AI is going to be created, it's better if it's done by like as competent and intelligent people as possible rather than by bumblers who don't know what they're doing. But the idea that we would keep one step ahead just doesn't really hold water. The ultimate limits to information processing in machine substrate are far outside the limits in biological substrate. Like the human brains have fundamental physiological constraints that just don't obtain in machine substrate. Like a human neuron is slow, and maybe it fires at 100 hertz or 200 hertz, like 200 times a second. Even a present day transistor is operating at a gigahertz. Like signals propagate slowly, maybe at 100 meters per second tops in an axon, whereas inside a computer, a signal can travel at the speed of light. And they're like big size limits to how large a brain can be. It like has to fit inside a cranium. Whereas like a computer can be the size of a warehouse or larger. So there are these fundamental physical reasons to think that ultimately the potential for information processing in machine substrate are just far beyond what's possible in biological implementation. So sooner or later, assuming we don't destroy ourselves in some other way first, I think we're going to face this transition to the machine intelligence era. So let me just, in the last part of my talk, say something about machine intelligence. So, when people, now we have kind of, I think about AI, I think there are these kind of milestones that maybe spring to mind, like some of you might remember Deep Blue, IBM's chess computer, which beat Garry Kasparov. So that was a big watershed moment. There have been other, like the self-driving cars, when they started actually to work. More recently, the game show Jeopardy, which is like a quiz show, trivia quiz show, where like trivia questions are asked in a slightly riddle-like format, and IBM again managed to beat a system that could defeat the all-time human champions on that. This was, you know, maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And recently, in the last 2 years, there has been a lot of excitement about breakthroughs in deep learning, which is a kind of, it's a neural network technology where, in the good old day of AI, like what people maybe tend to think about as AI, like it's basically like AI as a big box where you manually put in commands, you put in knowledge items, and then the AI becomes a big expert system and it can spit out logical implications of what. But those kinds of systems turn out not to scale, they were very brittle, you basically got out only what you put in. Today the action is really much more in machine learning, where researchers are trying to craft algorithms that have the same ability to learn from raw perceptual input as humans have. And so some of these pictures here, you can see the face and the cat, these were deep learning structures trained on images found on the internet, kind of image search. And the way that sort of Google image search has worked up until now has been basically without understanding what's in the image. So you have all these web pages where an image occurs, and then maybe there's a caption saying cat. And so then you could sort of guess that this picture probably has a cat in it if it occurs on a lot of pages where it says cat. What this deep learning thing does is actually looking at the raw pixels of the image and a large number of these, and it learns to extract the kind of representational features that are diagnostic of different kinds of images found on the internet, and then learns to classify those. So actually looking at the image and seeing what's in there rather than just looking at the kind of text labels. So when you did this on the internet, like one of the kind of archetypal representational features was a cat and a face. So these are apparently like common themes on the internet. And even more recently, some progress in combining deep learning with reinforcement learning, where they had with DeepMind, like a London-based company that was acquired by Google, a computer system that learned to play Atari games. But the interesting thing was, the same computer program could learn to play any of a wide range of different old Atari games without sort of being programmed specifically to train each one. So it just gets the raw pixels from the computer screen, and it has sufficient general purpose learning ability and planning ability that it could actually, on many of these games, achieve a superhuman performance, but not all. So underlying some of these developments, there's like a number of kind of algorithmic techniques that are used. We are still, like, it seems far away from being able to replicate the full generality of human learning ability and human intelligence. So one or more likely more, several of these kind of basic new concepts or insights would have to be created before we get to human level, but nobody really knows how many. You know, whether we're sort of 3 more of these away or 30 more of these away, like, we just don't have that ability to predict how far away we are from AI. What has also driven these advances in machine learning just as much as improvements in software has been hardware improvements. So with Moore's Law, kind of the rapidly expanding processing power available, it looks like, for example, if you look at the performance of chess computers, about half of the gains since Deep Blue have been due to algorithmic improvements, and about half just to having faster computers. And today, of course, chess computers are far above like human level. So these kinds of are already in use in many sectors of the economy. AI researchers sometimes complain that as soon as something actually works, it's no longer called AI. We just think of it as software or statistics. But a lot of these applications that are currently in use were originally invented or came out from machine learning research or AI research. In various game contexts where it's kind of easy to measure and compare performance of humans to AIs that have reached superhuman level, but they are still kind of more or less helpless when it comes to, say, common sense understanding, flexible planning, concept learning, all these things that make kind of humans so versatile. You can take a reasonably talented human and you can train them up to do pretty much any job out of thousands of different jobs. That we're nowhere near that with computers. we asked a couple of years ago some of the world's leading AI experts when they thought that human-level machine intelligence would be achieved, and the median date for when they thought there would be a 50% probability was 2050 or 2040, depending on which group of experts we asked. But this is obviously like just their subjective judgment, and there's like huge uncertainty. So the correct way to think about this is not to pick a particular date, and then to be really confident either that it will happen by that day or that it will not, but rather to think in terms of a probability distribution, and it should be smeared out over a very wide range of possible arrival dates, in my opinion. We just don't have any very precise ability to predict those things. But what I do argue in my book is that even when we do reach human level intelligence, I think there is a good chance that we will fairly soon after that have radical superintelligence. And so we have to distinguish between these two different questions, like how far are we from now to human level AI? And I'm pretty agnostic about that. But the second question is how fast is the takeoff from there on? And there, although we don't know for sure, I think there's a significant probability that that could be very rapid. That we could have an intelligence explosion. That then raises a number of important but tricky questions as to how, if we one day were to trigger such an intelligence explosion, where maybe each improved version of the machine intelligence uses its higher than human intelligence to make itself even smarter, and the smarter it gets, the better it gets at making itself even smarter. Like in that kind of scenario, how we could set up the initial conditions in such a way that you would end up with a superintelligence that were aligned with human values, that would have a beneficial impact on the world. And I think there are a number of technical research questions that have not been solved and were until very recently very neglected, except our group were doing something, and there was a group at Berkeley who was doing some work. So here there has been some shift, really, in the last like half year or year. I mean, like since the book came out, there has been this, well, partly I think also fueled by these advances in machine learning. So right now we're kind of in another hype cycle for AI. There have been a number of these hype bubbles in the past that ended up with disillusionment and disappointment, and now we are in the third wave of excitement about AI, and I mean it's anybody's guess whether this will go all the way through or whether there will be more. But so there has been like interest by some of the leaders. Elon Musk, for example, the great technology entrepreneur, let's get this, SpaceX, he does the Tesla, the electric cars. So he donated very recently $10 million of his own money to fund research on the AI control problem. A number of other people have kind of expressed similar views on this topic. Stephen Hawking, Bill Gates recently came out. So there seems to be a shift at the moment, maybe where this will is moving from being a kind of backwater science fiction thing that no people were taking seriously to actually becoming a legitimate area of research. And I'm not saying general AI, there's obviously much more resources and people going into trying to accelerate AI. I'm saying specifically the idea of thinking now about if and when we could create machines that reach human level and then superintelligence, how could we engineer the control systems for these AIs so that they would end up being friendly to humans? And this looks like one of those existential risks that might be relatively susceptible to effort now. There are other existential risks from wars and arms races in the future, and obviously it would be much better if we could make the world more peaceful and increase global harmony, but it's also very hard for a small group of people to make a big difference to how much world peace there is. By contrast, it is still possible for a small number of people or a small number of extra funding dollars or talented people to make a significant difference to the total amount of brain power that the world is applying to working out a solution to this AI control problem in advance. So there's a lot more that we could talk about, but what I want to really do is maybe open it up for Q&A, and then I'm happy to sort of follow the conversational thread wherever you want to take it. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
José Ramón, por favor. He's going to just wrap up, say a few words, and then we'll start the discussion very quickly. Thank you. It's super intelligence you need.
Okay. Well, I think you've given us an incredible view of ourselves, our future, our potential, our risks, our responsibilities. Many people here who have children, grandchildren, you know, they probably have never thought that we are facing a world that's going to be transformed radically in the next couple of decades, maybe even more. But and that gives us a context of great worry on the one hand, of responsibility on the other, and also of potential joy. I mean, there are many people, Rick Kurzweil, Minsky, James Rees, Eric Drexler, Ramez and others who say, well, you know, we are facing technologies that are so powerful, it will solve all the problems that mankind has faced in the past and recently, you know, from war to disease, famine, etc. But of course, this is one side of the artificial intelligence explosion, you know, the possibility of solving those things. But you have put the problem in a most academic and meticulous, methodical way. I think for the first time we have now a blueprint of what we can explore in order to make our world safer. Dr. Carlos Elizondo, just a moment ago, was remarking that he was amazed, as we all are, that you could imagine, you know, creatively, the different paths and the different dangers and the strategies that we could follow in order to make the world safer. Mark Texmark, the cosmologist, said, for example, if you are going to buy a trolley for your baby, you know, it has 1% chance of failing and killing your baby, well, you would invest the world in order to avoid that. And that comes back to your graph, you know, when you read. What is it? Well, when you put, we put little effort in the risk for humanity. However, and if I may begin, I have an issue. Yeah, well, I have one question. The question is that you are talking about, of course, artificial intelligence and superintelligence. Now, I do not know if that superintelligence is just an AI or actually an artificial general intelligence. Because if you are talking about an artificial general intelligence, there is something that, at least to me, made a difference. When David Deutsch said, well, you know, an artificial general intelligence is necessarily qualitatively different from any AI. Why? Because an artificial general intelligence has to have the same abilities and as human beings have to produce conjectured explanations, to explain the world, to see itself in the world. And so the orthogonal thesis that you mentioned, which is, well, you know, there you have a super intelligent being but wanting to optimize the production of paperclips in the world. Well, will that superintelligence not see itself and not reflect? Well, what is this? This is absolutely crazy. What is this? That is one. I mean, I think an issue that it would be very good if you can clarify. And another is Professor Ben Goetzel's idea that, well, you know, if you're going to create an AGI, it has to have an inbuilt uncertainty, and hence there's no possible path to provability of a safety strategy towards superintelligence. Sorry that I hope I was.
This is okay. Yeah, thank you for those questions there. I do have in mind general artificial intelligence, general in the same sense, at least that human intelligence is general. I think that there is a kind of natural convergence point to general that is the capability to do computer science research, maybe a special cognitive ability, but
It's one which there would be a lot of incentives to get the AIs to have, because then you could use that to develop any other mental faculties that you don't have at the outset. On the question of the, so I didn't really have time to kind of go into it, but you allude to this orthogonality thesis, which is the claim, which I argue for in the book, that there is no necessary connection between intelligence and motivation. That is, that you could in principle have any level of intelligence with pretty much any goal or motive. So there's no necessary connection, for example, between being very intelligent and being very nice and kind, or being very evil. Like, you could have any combination. You could have a very dumb person who's very, like, morally good, or very bad, and like, even within the human, like, narrow human range, that's possible. We see that, and the space of artificial minds is much, much larger, and you have even more ability there to combine different. So I think there is no no contradiction. In fact, not even really a tension between, say, the idea of an AI that is super intelligent, general super intelligent, and has as its only goal, say, to make as many paper clips as possible. And we in this context, we have to think of this general super intelligence as instrumental reasoning capabilities. So this system, the way I'm thinking about it, would be extremely good at figuring out which plants would achieve what effects in the world. It would be able to then check these different possible plants against its criteria for selecting an action. Maybe this particular AI has as its criterion to maximize the expected number of paper clips in the future. And even though the goal is one that we would regard as totally meaningless and dumb, it might be superhumanly effective at finding means that would achieve this goal. And if such a superintelligence were let loose in the world, it might result in a future that was full of paper clips, but with no humans. In general, you can replace the goal paperclips with almost any other goal. I mean, if you think through what the organization of matter and resources would be that would maximally realize almost any other arbitrary goal that you might pick, for most possible goals, there would be no role for humans. So the world with the most paperclips is a world with no humans. Like, humans have bodies that consist of atoms. Those atoms could be made to use paperclips. So it actually is quite difficult to specify a goal such that if maximally realized, the world would still contain human values. And that's one of the kind of challenges that I think some research could be done on now. This is the orthogonality thesis, that we can't just assume as long as you make something intelligent enough, it will sort of automatically discover what is good. Well, maybe it would, but also then it would have to be automatically motivated to pursue that good, and that's what I don't think follows. Like, maybe a sufficiently smart human would be able to figure out what we meant by good, to be able to participate in a moral philosophy seminar, but there would be no necessary connection between having that understanding and being motivated to act on it. I mean, even again, within humans, we have, say, psychopaths who might be clever in many cases, able to understand what other people are thinking, what they want, and they just don't care. And so in basically the same way, you could have an AI that was really good at modeling humans and understanding our discourse, but just had other goals.
Thank you very much. Professor Poré would like to pose a question, and then we'll open the floor, so please be prepared and ask for the mic if you are interested in asking a question.
Yeah, well thank you for your presentation. It was really interesting, and I may take advantage of some of the questions that are out there, but what we have in this room is a group of people that are literally leaders of one of the emerging economies and countries in the world that has a number of characteristics that, connectedness to the U.S. and to all of the other markets, a massive human capital ready to have and already having significant influence in a number of fields, both in an economy and in industry and in human capital development. And in particular, this school, the School of Government and Public Transformation, has a PhD program. And we are rethinking how to develop this program, and we're very concerned about these issues. And so the question that I will pose to you is a slightly more general than what should I do with my PhD, but I want you to think about, let's assume that I were able to gather money, say $10 million, not that much, but solid amount of money to develop human capital over the next 5 years. What kind of things would you have them doing? This is relevant not just for us, it is relevant for people like the president of our of CONACYT. It's also relevant for some of the leaders on the media that are here with us in terms of what are the kinds of things that we should be helping our human capital learn, develop, especially when we think about our capacity to contribute to this Maxipoc principle. We're worried about that. We're concerned about that. How can we, is it just computer science that we should be developing, learning, teaching?
I guess so it depends a little if the objective is to kind of have a lot of intellectual capital here, then the easiest way might just be to move it from elsewhere. So to improve recruitment and selection, you know, move one talented person from one place to another. It's a lot harder to build up capital within an existing group. It adds more to the world maybe, but it's harder to do. So the Maxipoc rule is really mainly aimed at answering the question of what one should do insofar as one wants to do what's best for the world. Like, what should an altruist do? So most people are not altruists. Maybe they are like 1% altruist or 5%. But they care a little bit about doing good for the world, but they also care about their family and friends and themselves. And I guess my suggestion there might be to optimize separately for these different objectives, rather than doing something that kind of does in a half-baked way on each. So make as much money as possible and donate a small fraction of that to the most effective cause that is specialized in reducing existential risk. That it might be better than trying to sort of slightly change what you're doing in the hope that it will have some side effect. So I believe in sort of the division of labor. Like if you want a really great cardigan, you probably don't like learn knitting and try to make your own cardigan and take some time off work to learn to knit. You make money doing what you're good at, and then you pay somebody else to knit the cardigan. And in the same way, if you're interested in buying existential risk reduction or some other good for the world, maybe you do what you're good at, and then you transfer some amount of resources to other people who are like specialized in that.
Do we have any question in the floor? We have two there, please. First one. Ahí, por favor, Andrés.
Professor Bostrom, about your presentation, you talked about how machine intelligence may be one of the potential black ideas that we haven't come up yet. But you've talked about how machine intelligence may be one of the black ideas that we haven't developed yet. But why is it that machine intelligence can be a black idea? Why do we consider it to be like a potential harm rather than seeing it like a utopian future in which machine intelligence can actually make societies better rather than this dystopian perspective that we have?
Yeah, no, so I think it can be the latter. If we solve the control problem first, then superintelligence could be the best thing that will ever have happened to the human species. Because, so the way to think about AI, it's not just AI. Like, AI is really everything else as well. Because with superintelligence, you then have a superhumanly strong ability to invent all the other technologies. That everything, so it kind of means a telescoping of the future. So think of all the things that humans could have developed if we had worked on it for another 20,000 years, like all kinds of science fiction technologies. Right? That's a lot of stuff. All of that could happen very quickly once you have like the research being done at digital timescales by some superior intelligence. But I think that it's also possible that things could go wrong. The basic intuition here is superintelligence could be very powerful for the same reasons that humans are very powerful relative to other animals. So gorillas are much stronger than we are physically. And yet the fate of the gorillas now depend a lot more on what we do than on what the gorillas do. And that's because our brains are slightly different and that gives us this technological edge and we can make cleverer plans and so forth. And so for basically the same reason, something that was like as superior to us in general intelligence as we are to the great apes could be very powerful relative to us. In some scenarios at least, able to shape the future according to its desires. So then everything would depend on what those desires, what those preferences were. Now, it looks non-trivial to endow an artificial agent with preferences that coincide with human preferences. So if you ask what we could do right now, for example, well, right now it would be possible to program a computer to, say, want to compute as many digits in the decimal expansion of pi as possible. That's something you could do in Python or C++. So solve some simple mathematical problem. But what we might have no clue about how to go about doing today would be like giving an AI a goal like maximize love or justice or beauty or complexity or like any other humanly meaningful value. We just have no idea how to express that in computer code. So if somebody figured out how to create an AI today, there's a risk that all the goals we would be able to give it would be these kind of very simplistic, reductionistic goals that didn't capture everything we care about. And then you might have a future optimized for that, like kind of flawed value. And so what we need is some way to like more flexibly align advanced artificial intelligence with human interests. And there are various ideas for how to go about doing this. Basically, you'd have to, it looks like the most promising routes would involve using machine learnings to have the AI learn human values rather than for us to sort of specify a complete tableau of everything we care about. But there are still unsolved questions there in how, even if you got the AI to learn what it is that we value, you still have to have that connected up to the AI's motivation system so that it's actually motivated. And some other technical problems in decision theory, and like I could go into more details, but some seemingly quite difficult technical problems that we might fail to solve. And this problem is particularly difficult because it might be that we only get one stab at it. Like once you have an unfriendly superintelligence out there, it might be too late. Like it might then resist attempts to change it. So human beings are not necessarily very good at anticipating a complex problem, getting it all solved correctly on the first try. Like we usually muddle through, we learn from experience and adapt. And so that's why I think there is this particular need to mobilize in advance, maybe many decades in advance, some top mathematical talent to really work through the foundations of this.
Let me just very quickly follow this question. But the problem is that individuals might want to use this super machine to affect other individuals. You mentioned in your book that maybe governments are secretly developing this super intelligence because they can be the most powerful arms imaginable. What are the dilemmas in terms of governance of artificial intelligence that you currently envisage as more important, that would be of interest for a school of governance like ours, in terms of what are the institutions we need to create to try to confront these risks?
So my thinking is not yet as well developed on that question. So I mean, there are basically two big problems. So one is this technical control problem, which in principle you could solve by having enough clever people working on it for long enough. And unless you solve that problem, you don't even get the shot at solving the second problem. You get paperclips rather than... So if we solve that problem, then it's true, we have this additional problem, like what values, if we could actually make the AI pursue some human value, like which human values, and which kind of political institutions should determine those, and how can we set things up? I think the failure scenario here for humanity is to have a technology race with a lot of different independent actors, each pursuing their own AI, and racing to get there first, because in that scenario, you don't have the ability to pause at the end if you haven't yet solved the control problem. What you would want is the first product that gets close to have the ability, if necessary, to slow down for a year, for 3 years, for 5 years, if there's still work to be done to make sure that the control problem is correctly solved. But the more people you have in the race, the harder it will be to do that. So ideally, it would be better to have a coordinated product where everybody had a stake in the upside, that we could all contribute to, rather than to have each little nation like or company racing to get there first. But exactly how to accomplish that, I don't yet have the answer to. I mean, I would say that I think it's important to get in at this early stage, this notion, a common goods principle, you could have other names, but it's basically the idea that if somebody develops machine superintelligence, there will be risk associated with that, and everybody, whether they like it or not, will be subject to those risks. And it therefore seems fair that everybody should also have some stake in the upside if things go well. Also, the potential amount of stuff that is suddenly available, and we're talking about the entire universe here, there's like more than enough for everybody to have like their own galaxy. Like there's no point in quibbling over the exact. So it's more important that we get something roughly right than that we get the allocation exactly right, I think. But human nature being what it is, there is still obviously still the concern that people will feel that that they need to be personally in control of this, or that their company or their nation or their bloc. So we are hoping to do more actual thinking about the kind of the policy aspects of this over the coming years, but there's a lot of and the reason we focused more on the technical stuff so far is because the leverage seems higher there. It seems, because it was completely neglected before, it's impossible even for just like 5 or 10 people to really double the total amount of effort the world was producing. Whereas it's harder to get like the world's great powers to work together in peace and harmony. Like, even though it's very desirable, it's just harder to see how a small research group like ours can make it like a significant difference on that.
Thank you. We have a question.
Yes. Well, first, Professor, thank you for your talk, for your lecture. It was wonderful. At your
point. Acércate al micrófono, por favor.
Sí. First, thank you, Professor. It was a wonderful talk, as your book. But I have a question, maybe two questions that are related. First, in your book, you talk about these two previous revolutions, the agricultural revolution and then the industrial revolution, right? That generate exponential growth in human societies. In the economy, right now, there is a, of course, growth is always an issue, but when you talk about superintelligence and how it will bring growth again, this kind of exponential growth, there is already many people in the academy that is talking about kind of this neo-ludism, I don't know how to tell, that you know, machines will take all the jobs, and there's a worry about public policy and that kind of economic issues. So the first part of the question is, how do you imagine that a superintelligence explosion will affect that kind of side of the society, of human societies, right? And the second part is, once we get to the human level AI, as you said, we may get this explosion, right? Immediately after. So there are people now, you know, like Ray Kurzweil, Elon Musk, you mentioned, that have this kind of enthusiasm that we should rush it because it will bring a lot of benefits. But there's also the issue you raise, right? That maybe there are certain existential threats there. Maybe rushing it will bring the black stone from the urn. So how you build, I don't know, how you imagine how to build an AI that has ethics, you know, that can distinguish ethical questions, so can improve or optimize social well-being, rather than being a threat?
Yeah, again, I mean, I think that it's relatively hard to have much influence over the speed with which we move forward towards AI, because there are so many drivers. There are like tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people in all countries around the world, in computer science, in neuroscience, in software engineering, in statistics, that are contributing with strong incentives for incremental progress. Like, if you have a spam filter, there's every reason to make it slightly more accurate in segregating, you know, spam emails from. So, and in all of these areas, there are like great benefits to having incremental progress. It's really hard to see how you could do much to either slow that down or speed it up. But you can have a big impact at the moment still, because it's still a very small field in how much work there is on the control problem. So that's why we're focusing there. Now, in terms of exactly how you would get an AI to be ethical and stuff, I think that is, broadly speaking, one of these questions that we still need the answer to. And not just a philosophical answer to, but like, you actually need computer code at the end of the day. Like, finally, that's what you need to express it to. There are philosophical questions on the path to that. So there are a number of different ideas that are still being explored. There might be new ideas that we need to get. A lot of them involve some form of machine learning to try to harness the AI's ability to learn. There are also ideas of trying to build something other than an artificial intelligence with goal. Maybe you could build some kind of question answering system and then use that as a leverage to get to more general form of intelligence. Or so in a large chunk of the book in the middle kind of tries to go through problems and advantages with different ones. On the first one, so there are a lot of other issues related to machine intelligence that are much more near term. Impact of automation on labor markets, like drones, autonomous vehicles, privacy concerns. So these are all legitimate issues, and some people should be thinking about those. I think they're just very different issues from the very distinctive kinds of problems that I'm talking about, which really only arise when you get like general human intelligence in machines. So I think they're all legitimate, but it's important not just to kind of lump them together into one. And I would be, in general, I guess, when thinking about these big picture questions, warn against kind of over extrapolating from recent trends. I think there is a tendency that if there is a big bust in the economy over the last 5 years, then people tend to imagine the long-term future for humanity has gone down. And then there's an upturn, and then we imagine utopia. But these are kind of small ripples on the great pond of humanity for the most part. And we need to try to abstract from the day-to-day and year-to-day noise if we're going to see the kind of underlying patterns that might possibly shape the long-term future. There is like another class of scenarios. I was kind of mostly alluding to these intelligence explosion scenarios where you have this transition happening very rapidly and once you get to human AI. And that kind of rapid takeoff scenario, then it becomes very important that the first superintelligence is human-friendly because it might become very powerful. It's the first superintelligence in the world where there is nothing else even comparable. But in another class of scenario, you have a more gradual takeoff, and then you might end up with a multipolar scenario where you have many different competing AIs with roughly comparable powers, and where you have a different set of concerns. You have more of economic dynamics maybe shaping this population of digital minds. Evolutionary dynamics operating on this population of digital minds. And you might then, as a first simple model, imagine a rapid population explosion because you have digital, so basically how you have human capital being copyable with software. You can copy it just as easily as you copy a computer program. You expect in the simplest model just to have investors kind of making more and more copies of these digital minds, AIs, until the average income that they earn equals the subsistence level for the AI, like the cost of electricity and hardware rental, which subsistence level will then be lower than the subsistence level for a biological brain, because we need housing and food and stuff. And so at that point, in the simplest model, it would become impossible for humans to make a living through wage income. And we would instead have to live from some other source of revenue, like capital gains or redistributive, like taxing the AI firms and like living off of that. And then you could wonder, even if we could implement something like that, to what extent would it be feasible to do this in a globally coordinated? Because if one regime, if one jurisdiction decided to like heavily tax robot corporations, say, and another didn't, then like the economic activity would just chip, and they would have this rapid growth, and like all the robots would be located in. So it might be necessary to have coordination there, which is hard to achieve, but maybe in these extreme circumstances, maybe it could. But like, how likely is it that that will then remain stable if you have this population of maybe trillions and trillions of digital minds and maybe just billions of human minds, and these digital minds operate much faster than us and are getting increasingly better? Like, how likely is it that humans will remain in charge and own most of the world's capital, like, as this digital economy just gradually begins to swamp the total fraction of the economy? And so in this kind of multipolar scenario, you have a different set of issues, but again, they also look quite challenging. Although it might be harder to see what we as individuals or small groups can do today that would increase the chances in this multipolar outcome than it is to see what we could do today that would increase the chances in the singleton outcome. Because there might be these few small technical problems where a small group of individuals today could fund or do the research that would have a disproportionate impact. If it's these big impersonal competitive forces that will shape multipolar outcome, it's just maybe harder to shift the future much.
Do we have any other questions? Well, we have three here, please.
Oh, I haven't read your book. I'm certainly planning to do so, but I would like to ask you about how do you define intelligence? Because of course there is the emotional intelligence, which seems to be very important for human survival. And there is this theory by Gardner about multiple intelligences, which has been very important in modern educational systems. So how do you define intelligence? Just as problem solving?
Yeah, so I don't spend much of the book trying to do that because in general, people can kind of get bogged down in definitions of intelligence. And then, so basically what I have in mind though is what you might call instrumental rationality, the ability to devise plans that are effective at achieving different goals, mobilize available means. In terms of, so there are all kinds of domain limited. So right now we have computers that are superhuman in very narrow domains, like calculating large numbers or memorizing data and playing chess and a number, but they don't have the same kind of general purpose learning ability that humans have. I do think that there is a kind of convergence. Once you reach a sufficient level of either general intelligence or engineering intelligence, then you can use that to achieve all the other kinds of intelligence that you didn't have initially. So if you had an AI that had a superhuman ability to perform computer science research, let's say, or AI research, then it could use that particular skill in that particular cognitive domain to create mental modules, to extend its algorithms, to do all the other things that it cannot initially do. So if that is correct, it might not matter exactly which cognitive abilities you developed first. Like once you get a sufficient amount, particularly of this engineering superpower, you can then use that to get all the others that you didn't have initially. So that all sufficiently advanced AIs would kind of be equivalent in terms of their profile of cognitive strengths and weaknesses. And that the only differentiator might be the amount of computing power they have or the amount of information they have. Would be a conjecture, but I think a fairly plausible one.
We have two questions here. Isidro, por favor.
Thank you very much. I'm Isidro Morales from the School of Government. I really enjoyed your talk. We all know that the desire and the dream of becoming more intelligent is not new. At the turn of the 20th century, we have a great movement of scientists, of physicians, trying to enhance human intelligence and what was called at the time human race. And the movement was called eugenics, as we know. But we all know that social and political consequences of eugenics, when it was recovered through political purposes and nationalistic reasons. And it's very old that human beings want to enhance their material capabilities in order to become stronger, perhaps not more intelligent, this is brand new, 20th century, but stronger. And we had machines. And the Industrial Revolution was one of the major outcomes. But we also know the consequences. We have good consequences, but also we have hegemonic possibilities for certain countries or certain people. For example, the British Empire was possible thanks to the Industrial Revolution. And we can put other examples, as for example, how to enhance life. Thanks to that, in the 19th century, we have Pasteur and bacteriology. But we also have bacterial weapons. So my point is, we all know, and we have enough experience, enough historical record, that technological change creates differential capabilities. I want to put it in a term. There is a gap in capabilities. Some countries, some people, some groups, they become stronger vis-a-vis others that they don't enjoy that capability, or where there is a gap in order to transfer that capabilities. So I want to suggest to you that when we are once again thinking how to become more intelligent, how to survive more, how to enlarge the life cycle, to introduce not only your concept, which I like it, of existential risk, but the concept of capabilities gap. And to think how to become more intelligent, how to enhance life, not only to avoid or to reduce existential risk, but to reduce the capability gap. I wonder whether this is possible in our generation and for this time.
A lot of dimensions to that question. it's possible that issues relating to capability gaps flow into the question of existential risk, insofar as one might think the long-term future for humanity looks more or less promising, depending on whether the world has greater or smaller amounts of inequality or capability gaps. And it's not immediately obvious which direction that goes in. Whether it's possible to reduce capability gaps, I mean, certainly it's technologically possible. I mean, to a large extent, I think it's a question of political decisions and values, which there is like an enormous literature on, an enormous number of people in different parties pulling in one way or another. It looks like the kind of issue it's hard for a small, like, extra amount of resources to make much difference to, because people love to join like a political tug of war. Like, there's a rope and there's like half of the people are pulling it left and half of them are right. And a lot of people's first instinct is to run to this rope and then join one side or the other. Like, different people join different side, but they feel that that's like what the issue is. And so they want to participate there. But for somebody who wants to make the maximum positive difference in the world, it's not clear that joining those kinds of political tussles is where the highest leverage is. It might be doing something different that other people are not really focusing very much on. If we're talking specifically about human enhancement, like biomedical things, it's interesting because there we have a couple of different countervailing factors. So on the one hand, when human enhancement technologies become feasible, you might expect that at first they will be available to people who have more resources. Like, things are initially expensive. The rich can, you know, maybe not just send their kids to better schools, but maybe they could also give their kids, like, they could have the best kind of genetic selection to get the most talented kids and so forth. That would be like, tends to increase inequalities. On the other hand, in many cases, for some enhancements, I think it is easier to increase the capabilities of those who start from a low level. Like, if there are more things wrong with you to begin with, it's easier to make big gains than if your organism is already kind of operating close to its optimal functionality. So it's easier in medicine to help somebody with a broken leg than it is to help somebody whose legs are functioning perfectly. I think a different source of diversity or gap creating might be that different cultures have different attitudes towards this. So particularly with, like, say, embryo selection, you could easily imagine that different countries just have very different cultures and different religious values to this. And that even if they all had access to the technology, some might just be much more aggressive in using it. And for example, in places you mentioned eugenics, so in some parts of the world, there is a very strong kind of historical scar where the history of eugenics looms very large in the public consciousness, and there's a big taboo on anything kind of even vaguely related to, like, the Nazi crimes. And in other parts of the world, like maybe in Asia, that's not as big a part of their history, and they might have different attitudes. And so once the technology is available, there might be very different kinds of attitudes and adoption of this technology, and that might also result in big gaps in human capital, as like some parts of the world might embrace this technology and kind of move ahead more rapidly. One might think that even the parts that are initially reluctant might, when they kind of, for this fear of falling behind, might eventually kind of change. If really this came to be seen as the key to remaining, like, competitive in science and technology and economic strength and military strength, then maybe some countries with scruples initially would kind of gradually, or maybe the elites of those countries would, like, go on medical tourism holidays to have, like, some fertility thing done in a clinic in Singapore or something, and then there are a lot of different scenarios in which this can play out, but presumably it's not going to be uniformly implemented across the world, and so that again might create new kinds of differences in capabilities and inequalities, adding to all the kinds of differences that we already have.
We have time for two more questions. Dos preguntas más. ¿Dónde está el micrófono? Acá, por favor.
Buenas tardes, Amstor. Mi respuesta aquí es para el doctor. del Tecnológico de Monterrey. Hace ratito comentaba, doctor, de qué manera puede uno aportar aquí con el doctor Armstrong. Yo tengo un comentario y a lo mejor yo creo que va a ser más que aportar. Creo que esos 10 millones de dólares que comentó figuradamente que se podían aportar para aquí el doctor, a lo mejor si nosotros los invirtiéramos en los estados y en la gente marginada que no conoce los estudios y no conoce las escuelas ni la educación, yo creo que esa sería una muy buena inversión para que ese tipo de gente saliera adelante y el día de mañana los viésemos aquí junto con el doctor. ¿O usted qué me responde?
Muchas gracias. Alejandro, ¿quieres contestar?
Yo creo que ese es precisamente el reto que tenemos. Es decir, lo dije muy brevemente al inicio, pero ese es el objetivo de este seminario. México no puede ser solamente testigo de este cambio. Decía Isidro Morales, tenemos una brecha de capacidades y nos presentan riesgos existenciales genuinos que están ocurriendo, que se están desarrollando. Y la pregunta es, bueno, vamos a nosotros, digamos, dentro de una situación de tanta oportunidad, vamos simple y sencillamente a ver que esto ocurra y decir, ah, mira, dentro de 10 años nos cuentan cómo vamos. No, no podemos hacer eso. Y justamente el reto, creo yo, es que una comunidad como esta nos ayude a desarrollar el conocimiento, el expertise, el capital humano y en el último de los casos, pero el más importante, la influencia para que este desarrollo tecnológico exponencial justamente atienda a las necesidades no solamente de sobrevivencia existencial de la raza humana, sino de desarrollo y transformación de nuestra realidad. Y creo que ese es el reto para el Tecnológico de Monterrey y la comunidad que tratamos de convocar el día de hoy. Pero estoy totalmente de acuerdo contigo. En el último de los casos depende de nuestra capacidad de ejercer influencia en la vida cotidiana de un montón de personas. Que me gustó mucho la forma en la que el profesor Bostrom inició, diciendo incluso los cambios más pequeños en nuestro probabilidad de riesgo existencial tienen implicaciones literalmente en trillones de vidas humanas. Y vamos a empezar rápido, pero desde nuestro entorno.
Muchas gracias. Por favor, la última pregunta y para allá vamos a cerrar.
Thank you very much for your talk, Dr. Bostrom. I would like to ask about the work that you conduct in the Future of Humanity Institute. How do you work? How do you plan this work that you have? I understand that you have a team working there with you. Do you work interdisciplinarily? I would like to know how do you work in the Future of Humanity Institute.
Is not only that, but what's your future agenda? And not only the one you are doing, but the one you cannot do because you have limited time and limited resources, what kind of agenda pending in this type of issues?
So we are multidisciplinary. We're a small group, but we have mathematicians, computer scientists, philosophers, engineers, neuroscientist, and a lot of us actually have backgrounds in more than one area as well. So it's not pick an arbitrary mathematician, an arbitrary philosopher, and an arbitrary and hope that something interesting will happen. That it usually doesn't work like that. It's like a particular kind of a person who's, and it's hard to really. There is no simple recipe, I think, for doing this. It doesn't. A lot of the time, when wrestling with these questions. A big part of the challenge is what is the kind of right methodology, what are the right concepts even, what is the right question to ask is often not at all obvious. And so we're trying to take something where there is initially just a model, some sense that there is some important issue, it's not really clear what the analytic tools are, and then try to clarify it enough that one can begin to break it apart into subparts where those parts eventually then become ones that can be tackled with ordinary scientific methods, statistical methods, CIS methods.
And as far as the agenda is concerned, well, so there, we don't. So there are kind of two main focus areas. That so one is AI safety work, like kind of technical work and control problem, and another is what I call macro strategy, which is trying to think through the overall strategic situation for humanity, particularly with a view of answering the question, if your goal is to do as much expected good as possible, what should you do? So there are a number of these macro parameters, like faster or slower rate of technological progress in different fields, more surveillance and transparency, or more privacy? Do we want a more centralized world order with a world government, or do we want more decentralized things with a lot of independent actors? Do we want, where it's not obvious even what the right direction is to push in? So try to answer one of these questions. It turns out often depends on having some view about what the answer is to the other. So take cognitive enhancement. Like, do we want faster or slower rate in cognitive enhancement? Would that increase or reduce the risks from existential risk from machine intelligence? So thinking through these kinds of things and developing the concepts that make it possible to actually formulate specific questions and move this general area from sort of journalism and science fiction and popular science into like an actual academic research is what we want to do. But we don't have a very detailed like plan stretching out 5 or 10 years, because to a certain extent what we want to do is also to be able to move quickly to opportunities that we spot and have that kind of, it's almost like a kind of commando force that like you have like the Delta Force in the US, that they don't have a plan which people they will murder or which countries they will go into or which hostages they will rescue. But there is some value in being able to move quickly into new areas and then maybe to create, in our case, try to create a subfield in academia. Like, we're trying to do something with AI safety now, and there might be other opportunities like that in the future.
Well, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to have the chief of this super commando that is trying to save the world. Muchas gracias a todos por estar con nosotros. It was a great pleasure to be in conducting this discussion. Alejandro, gracias, José Ramón, and hope to see you soon in the next session of this seminar. Gracias a todos.
Tenemos, perdón, un certificado que le va a entregar el doctor Alejandro Poranik Bostrom.